Great. Now, thank you, Rob. It's always pleasure. It's a real pleasure to come to London. The first time I came here was in 1993 for the same symposium when Gene Brownwell was on it. And it's nice to be back here 20 years later and to be the recipient. I have a special place in my heart for London because London is the university that has collaborated most with us. Rob, you, Bill, Neville Susskind, Malcolm Arnold, young Amit Garg. There are so many people, the surgeons, they've all collaborated. So your kindred spirit. And last evening in our rather animated discussion with your dean, who I think was so traumatized, he's not at the lecture. So we suggested the possibility of the fact that both groups are medium-sized, very good, complementary. Maybe we should do more together and on a more formal level. Now, mostly when people introduce me, they never fail to mention Oxford. And you all wonder, what's about Oxford? I mean, it could be any other place, you know, it could be Oxford, Ontario. But my supervisor, Peter Slide, once when we were at the AHA and he didn't have a room, so he asked me, can I share your room with you? You know, I'm a fellow, he's the professor, and he had a grand title, Field Marshal Alexander, Professor of Cardiovascular Medicine. So I shared a room with him, and he thought he had to be nice to me, so he took me down to dinner, bought me a drink, and then he told me, and he was sort of regaling other people with this story about Oxford, and he was talking about these two Italian ladies, and excuse my Italian accent, and let's imagine one is Rosa and the other one is Elsa, and Rosa and Elsa are going in this double-decker bus in Oxford, and Rosa asks Elsa, so Elsa, what did you do for your 50th wedding anniversary? And Elsa said, my Carlo, he took me to the 7th Michelin star restaurant, and the food was fantastic. So Rosa then says, what else? So she says, oh, take me to Harrods and buy me this fur coat. And so she says, very nice. Then she says, she thought she better impress, Rosa. And so she says, so what else? Oh, he took me home and he was like a man of 50 years younger. And so Rosa says, very nice. So Elsa's getting a little antsy here. So she asks, so Rosa, what did you do? Oh, she says, Luigi, she says, Rosa, your English no good. I send you to Oxford University to learn elocution. So she said, what happened? Well, before I went to Oxford, I used to use coarse words like bullshit. Now I say very nice. So it's very nice to be here. Over the next 45 minutes, I'm going to take you through a journey, not through the galaxy, but through a set of imagination. I don't know whether any of this will come true, and if so, which parts. So let's get going. Well, the global burden of disease has said between 1990 and 2020, ischemic heart disease and cerebrovascular disease will climb from being number one and number four in the world. And there's been a marked decline in respiratory infections, diarrheal diseases, perinatal diseases, and various other diseases. Depression will become common. So, there's a career for those who want to go into psychiatry. Road traffic accidents will be number three, and no medical school in the world, as far as I know, has a department on road traffic accidents, but there's an important area of research. So the issue is, what can we do about ischemic heart disease, cerebrovascular disease, and that's the theme of my talk. In 1994, we started a case control study called Interheart with $25,000, and ultimately it grew to 28,000 people, 14,000 cases, 14,000 controls, and it was done in 52 countries. The question we asked was most of the risk factors for heart disease known or unknown? And if it was unknown, what were they? And we also asked the question, were the risk factors the same in different parts of the world? Interheart showed something that surprised us, that 90% of the risk of a heart attack or a stroke globally was accounted by 9 simple risk factors, and these risk factors had a similar effect in all regions of the world. We then did the interstroke study, and in the pilot phase of 6,000 people, we found a similar result. The full-scale study on 30,000 people will be finished next year. For a few years, we thought we had cracked it all, but then reality set in, and we realized these studies had limitations. First, what caused the risk factors? Why did they occur? Second, are all the risk factors causally related to a heart attack or stroke? And today, I must admit, I have doubts that diabetes is a causal risk factor of heart disease. I have doubts that low HDL is a causal risk factor for heart disease. Then the third one is, such a study, a case-control study, does not tell you what the risk factor burden in a population is, what the incidence of mortality of cardiovascular disease is in different parts of the world. So we coined this term in our group, caused. What are the causes of the causes? What causes the risk factors? So that's been one of the driving forces of our work. And we said there were 4 causes that caused it. And note, genetics isn't part of it, because in the 1900, cardiovascular disease was rare. And yet by 1950s, it became the single biggest cause of death in the world, and genes didn't change in 50 years. So we said there were 4 industrial diseases. There was tobacco, automobiles and urbanization, calorie-dense foods and soft drinks, and ultra-processed foods. Tobacco was used from the 16th century onwards in the Western world. After people went across to the New World, they brought tobacco back. But they had to roll it up and cure it and do all the things, just like our mayor in Toronto has to do, you know. So you can't have industrial levels of crack cocaine or industrial levels of tobacco. You smoked it one at a time, maybe 1 or 2 a day. But the real breakthrough in the use of tobacco happened when the cigarette machines were invented around the time of the First World War, when you produced tens and hundreds of thousands of cigarettes a day, and then it was given to the troops so that, you know, they were on a high before they went off and got shot to pieces. Well, much like our mayor, I guess. But and then it started to increase, and the second one is automobiles. 1910, Ford, Henry Ford makes the Model T. You can start to travel long distances, and so the cities started to change. People didn't need to live close to the center. You could live far away. The cities in North America, which are the new cities, are built around the motor car because you could travel distances. But being built around the motor car meant you didn't walk. You didn't cycle. So again, the motor car is the second cause of heart disease. The third is the changing nature of food. Undernourishment, starvation was common in the 1900s. I remember as a child in India, the newspapers would have papers, things on famine. You don't see that in India anymore. Undernutrition has been replaced by overnutrition because of better methods of food production, better methods of food storage, and because of processed food. On one hand, we've sort of not cured, but at least diminished the impact of undernourishment and also food poisoning. The number of people that would die from food poisoning and was very high. That's much, much less common today in the Western world. So we like to dump on the food industry, but in reality, they've done a lot of good. Although, you know, too much of a good thing is bad. And that's where we are with food. So the challenge with food is how can we take modern day technology, increase the productivity, the accessibility, and the preservation of food, but yet make it healthy. And ultra-processed foods like trans fats and salt. Well, too much salt is bad. Salt is a controversial issue. And my own belief, and we are just sending 2 papers on 100,000 people each to the New England Journal this week. They want the paper. And I can tell you, the Canadian salt guidelines, even the revised guidelines, are simply wrong. But we'll come to that later. So here is the the association of different foods and tobacco, you'll see they track with each other. More tobacco use, more alcohol use. More tobacco use, more soft drinks use. More tobacco use, more processed food. So the root cause of all of this is the modernization or an industrialization of all of those. Now, if you look at what's happening in the world, in high-income countries, tobacco use is plateaued out. But in the poorer countries, it is going up there, which means the tobacco epidemic is going to shift from the developed worlds into the developing world. And the same thing with soft drinks. You will see in Western world, it's plateaued out, but in the other parts of the world, it's increasing. When I go to South America and stay with my friends, their children will not drink water. They'll all drink pop. And you'll see that. Now, part of it, they say, is because water isn't healthy. But surely in wealthy or middle-class families, they have good water. But they have got used to the idea of drinking Coca-Cola, or as they say, Coca. So let's now come to tobacco. And tobacco is the one condition where we've had an impact by having an industrial approach to controlling it, and that is through legislation. Now, the first evidence that tobacco was harmful was available in the 1950s. And the first countries were small case control studies in the UK, in the US, and in Nazi Germany. Now, please don't shoot me for this, but Nazi Germany was the first country that banned public smoking of tobacco. Now, last time I said that, somebody called me anti-Semitic for saying that. So please, none of you do that. I'm just saying that as a historical fact. Since then, there was the British Doctors Study, where Sir Austin Bradford Hill and Richard Doll set up the study in British doctors. And they studied them. And the idea then is the government told them, cancer is going up, so find out the causes of cancer. And they thought that the causes of cancer was air pollution, not tobacco. And they just measured tobacco. Then, after about 10 years, they found tobacco was increasing the cause of all kinds of things. They shared this with the doctors who looked at this, and they said, oh my God, this must be real. It kills doctors, not just any people. Then they looked at it even harder. They said, this doesn't kill any doctor, it kills British doctors. So guess what the British doctors did? They stopped smoking, or some of them did. And so this study in the 50-year follow-up that was published in 2004, same time as the Interheart study was published, showed that if you stopped smoking before the age of 40, you obviated most of the adverse effects of tobacco. But it took 60 years from the evidence on tobacco, probably 200 studies, for the world to take notice. And it took 15 years of negotiations at the UN level, and we have the first international legislation for the improvement of health. It's called the Framework Convention on Tobacco Control. It provides for a comprehensive ban on advertising and promotion, but it still happens. Like in Canada, cigarillos are being sold as a way of bypassing the law and giving it to kids. It still happens in Ontario, although that's the last loophole that people are trying to block. Large health warning labels were required. In many countries, you really need huge things showing deteriorating gums, non-erecting vital parts, whatever. Deceptive labels were prohibited. Non-smokers had to be protected. That's why the bans on smoking in bars and in public places. And I have a little anecdote of this. Many years ago, many of you will remember, you had the smoking section in airplanes and the non-smoking section. How many of you remember that? Yeah, you do. So when I went to India and I requested a non-smoking section, I was seated right in the middle of it. The plane had just taken off, and the chap next to me lit a cigarette immediately. So I sort of turned to him and very sort of in a huff and said, this is the non-smoking section. He looks at me sort of quizzically and he says, yes, I know, I work for the airlines. But what has gone from having these laws is we're now implementing the laws. And so the content of the tobacco products had to be regulated, sale to minors prohibited, encouragement of tax rises. Out of the 192 countries in the world, 180 have signed it, but only 100 have ratified it. What does ratification mean? Like in the United States has signed it, but none of the states have ratified it. Health is a provincial or a state issue in many countries. Until it goes down to that secondary legislature level, it isn't ratified. Having said that, the US has actually implemented this. And much of our work around the world is being a witness. Do people actually implement these laws? And I'll tell you about that in a minute. We have a study in 23 countries, 750 communities, where we are tracking whether these laws are being implemented and whether that is then being associated with the decrease in smoking and therefore a decrease in smoking-related events. Now, the basis of banning of taxing cigarettes with these data from South Africa, where when the real price of cigarettes came down, the consumptions went up. And so this was the same thing. And so the countries that banned it, the 102 countries that implemented the ban, you will see a marked decline in tobacco use. In the others, it was much less. So these things work. And in future, I can see legislation relating to food. Trans fats is a good example where this will happen. Now, one of the studies we're doing is called the Prospective Urban-Rural Epidemiology Study that has enrolled 155,000 people from 628 communities in 17 countries from five continents, just being expanded to 200,000 people, but probably collect all of them in about 9 months. So there's North and South America, the countries in Africa. The countries we're expanding is to have two more in Africa, because at the moment we only have Zimbabwe and South Africa, the Middle East, including Iran. And I can tell you, we have very good investigators in Iran. I hope we don't nuke them. And then we have, Europe. We have a big group from China, 14 provinces from China, seven regions in South Asia and Southeast Asia, and Philippines has just joined. And with Philippines, it's interesting. They're terrific investigators. Their recruitment goes gangbusters till a typhoon hits them. And I can tell you, every typhoon, and they've had five typhoons this year, every typhoon for 2 weeks, they're collapsed, even if it's not the area where this has happened. So the beauty of such a study is we have high, middle, and low-income countries, and half the communities are urban, half the communities are rural, and it's global. Now, you need heterogeneity to understand most phenomena. 25 years ago, if you read the textbooks of epidemiology, it would tell you you needed studies that were homogeneous populations. This is complete humbug. For instance, if I tell you, if I only studied smoke, a population where everybody smoked, I could never find out smoking was bad for you. So you need heterogeneity, and that's the deliberate strategy of the study. Now, this study has many components, but one study is called EPOC, a sub-study that stands for Environmental Profile of Community Health. And these are on the first 628, we're expanding it to 750. And the goal is to characterize the environment. We talk about the environment, usually we mean smoking or diet or activity, but this is not environment, this is behavior. It's what causes you to smoke, what causes you to eat, what something, that's the environment. And the four domains we're looking at is the tobacco environment, the physical activity environment, the nutrition and diet environment, the social and economic environment, and we're just analyzing these data. But I'll show you some data on how we did this. We had to develop a new methodology. And this is a photo album of these 628 communities in 17 countries to be expanded. So we sent somebody to the middle of the town, or what is called, could be the bus station, the town hall, wherever it is. They take a photograph frontwards, then the right side, back side, left side, they cross the street and do the same thing, and then they go on a controlled walk. And in a controlled walk, they document everything related to tobacco, advertisements. Do they say children smoking tobacco? They look at the tobacco outlets and stand there and click at the number of people going in and out and whether any of them seem to be children. They walk into those places and see their advertisements, because under FCTC, you shouldn't advertise these in those shops. They go to every restaurant and either are given a menu or they steal a menu. And they go, and they go to every grocery store in that community, and they price an average food basket, because we have food frequency questionnaires and we know what people eat, and we price a healthy food basket. And incidentally, fruits and vegetables are violently expensive and unaffordable in most of the world. So it's okay that we can sit and say eat fruits and vegetables when people can't eat it. What's the point of it? Like in rural India, where we study, it's the food growing area. I mean, the fruit growing area, but they don't eat it, they sell it. So these are the things that we need to understand. And they also do that for walkability, to see if some area is walkable, are there places to walk to, are there sidewalks, is there bad traffic, are there dogs on the street, are people afraid of crimes? So we look at all of that. So this is an example of sweet drink advertisement versus BMI from our pilot study of 80 communities. And you'll see as sweet drink advertisement goes up, BMI goes up. But look at 25 up to 30. So if you can have communities with a 5-unit difference, that's telling you a lot. Or if you look at the built environment, the walkability, mixed land use. So our residential areas and commercial areas together, because if they're together, people will walk to work. If they're far away, they're going to take public transportation or drive. Is there common destinations to walk to? If there's a neighborhood store, you'll walk to it. If it's 2 kilometers away, you're going to drive to pick up the stuff. What are the traffic patterns? And is there pedestrian safety? Is there aesthetics? Is it free from crime and safety? And one of the things we found is that the effects of these vary in different communities. So in Canada, as the design and architecture improved, BMI decreased. Whereas in the poorer countries, as the design and architecture improved, it was exactly the opposite. The reason is people here tended to have their cars, live in fancier homes, and drove everywhere, even if they had to go around the corner. So the key thing is cultural factors overlay environment and then affect behavior. And so we came up with an aphorism. Societal factors are contextual. Biological factors are deterministic. So if you smoke, no matter what you smoke, you know, yeah, well, matters what you smoke, of course. But, you know, if you smoke tobacco, no matter what kind of tobacco, no matter which orifice of tobacco, it's going to be bad for you. You know, and people have done studies about different forms of tobacco use. Whereas for societal factors, context matters. This means social epidemiology is much tougher than standard epidemiology. Now, the other thing is, we're not very good at communicating. I mean, you know, here we have a meeting, I'm talking to like-minded people. Just before that, we had, I thought, you know, a more impressive method of communication chaired by Peter Lin, who's brilliant, Peter, with the lay public. But we need to start to use new methods of communication. Let me give you the all-time classic. And this is something I have only watched 10 minutes of, but my kids have watched it. It's called The Sex and the City, the greatest show on earth in terms of communication. And in every show, they have 150 items. And this is a way of subtle product placement. Or take movies. As a famous Hollywood director said, there is absolutely nothing accidental in a movie. For instance, in Men in Black, you can see aliens eating Burger Kings. And Burger King paid a ton of money for the movie. In Ghostbusters, there's a Coke bottle. No matter which angle you take, the Coke bottle is always in the front, in the foreground of that shot. Or you take Bond, when he switched from vodka martinis shaken or stirred to Heineken, the movie Bond franchise got £28 million. Or when M switched from one form of single malt to another single malt, it was £20 million. Or Batman and Robin, and he is sitting here and he's eating in Taco Bell. But imagine this. Here's Bond lying in a sexy pose, drinking his Heineken with this half-naked woman next to her. And instead of this, she says, "Dear Bond, dear James, have you taken your poly pill today?" Imagine the impact. We've got to start to think of new methods of communication. Now, what is the evidence all of this matters? These are data from a very nice study where they interviewed children about how long they were exposed to tobacco used in the movies. So grade 5, grade 6, 7, and 8. And the longer they were exposed, the higher the rate at which they tried smoking. So as one of my friends, Martin McKee, said, you know, we know movie stars, including Martin Sheen this evening, can't save lives, but at least they can stop killing people, i.e. stop smoking on the screen. Now, let me switch gears to my favorite topic on global cardiovascular disease. I started this talk by saying 80% of cardiovascular disease occurs in low and middle-income countries. But wait a minute, what does that mean? But 85% of the world lives in low and middle-income countries. So that's an empty nonsense statement. You know, it's a fool statement. And yet that's what every paper on global burden of heart disease starts, including my grants. So we asked ourselves, is that really true, number one? If it's true, do they have more risk factors or less risk factors? Is the incidence of cardiovascular disease higher and is mortality higher? And therefore, do you have higher cardiovascular disease mortality in the poorer countries? And if all that of that is true, this 80% is wrong. It's probably 90 or 95%. So we went to the PURE study. And in the PURE study, we divided people into the high-income, middle-income, and low-income countries. And from the INTERHEART study, we had an integrated risk score called the INTERHEART risk score that was validated. My colleague Sonia Annan did 2-3 studies validating it. And we found that the rich countries have the most risk factors, middle-income countries in between, and low-income countries in between. Ignore the rural-urban, and happy to take questions on it later. But this is 50% higher than here. So guess what? You would expect 50% more cardiovascular disease there than here. Well, let's see. The other thing we found is, yes, the INTERHEART risk score in PURE actually predicted cardiovascular disease. But this is the rich countries, this is the middle-income countries, this is the low-income countries. For the same level of risk factor, you had a 2- or 3-fold higher rate of disease. So something else is happening over and above the risk factors. And when you look at disease incidence, and let's start here, total cardiovascular disease, this includes heart attacks, strokes, heart failure, any hospitalization for cardiovascular disease like angina or arrhythmia or anything, yes, there is a marginally higher rate of cardiovascular disease in the rich countries compared to the other countries. But look at fatal cardiovascular disease, a 7-fold higher rate in the poor countries compared to the rich countries, and a 5-fold higher in the middle-income countries. If you look at incidence of disease, 20% higher in middle-income compared to high-income, and another 30% higher. So remember, the poor countries had 50% lower risk factors, but they have 50% more heart disease. So what is happening? But when you look at non-severe heart disease, it's 3 times higher or 4 times higher in the rich countries compared to the poor countries. And what is happening is in the rich countries, we're picking up disease early, we're bringing them into the hospital, doing things that prevents them from getting heart attacks, strokes, heart failure. But when they get the heart attack, strokes, we treat them better so fewer of them die. And that's what's seen in this trial. In this thing, you will see, this is what's called case fatality rate. And so everybody's had a disease, an event, but this is the case fatality rate. And this is high income, middle income, low income. And other than this, everywhere there's a graded relationship. And when you look at all major cardiovascular disease, 6% here, 2.5 times higher there, 3 times higher. And what goes along with that is you get better hypertension controls in the rich countries, poorer in the poorer countries. And if you look at secondary prevention, these are data we published in The Lancet a few years ago. This is use of antiplatelet agents, about 65% in the community in rich countries. And this includes Canada, 4 locations in Canada, Hamilton, Quebec City, Ottawa, and Vancouver. So even 5 years after heart attack, only 65% are getting aspirin. But look at how markedly lower it is in the upper middle income countries, low middle income countries, and it's only 5 to 10% in the poor countries. Beta blockers, the same trend. ACE inhibitors, the same trend. And if you look at statins, it's practically non-existent. This is a human tragedy. Simple, cheap, widely available, proven drugs. We can make a big impact on the health of people by putting systems into place that will improve the availability. Now, many years ago, when the Heart Protection Sue study came out, The Lancet asked me to write an editorial. And I theorized in a table that if somebody had a heart attack and they were treated with none of these drugs at 2 years, that they were discharged after 30 days, there would be an 8% event rate of mortality. Aspirin will lower it by a quarter, so 8 will go down to 6. Beta blockers will lower it by another quarter. 8 will go down to 4.5. And lipid lowering by 30%, so 4.5 will go down to 3. And ACE inhibitors by another quarter, so 3 will go down to 2.3. So if you used all 4, 8 will go down to about 2.5, which is a 75% risk reduction. This is my back of the envelope sort of calculation. A year later, a superb series of articles by Malcolm Law and Nick Wald and their colleagues, where they did a careful analysis of about 400 papers in the literature, and they came out with the term the polypill. And this is the cover page of the BMJ, and it said, a pill to prevent 80% of heart attacks. And the editor said, this may be the most important issue of the BMJ in 50 years. And then he goes on to say, I suggest, gentle or even angry reader, that you keep this issue of the BMJ. It may well become a collector's item. Later on, he keeps on saying, the economics and the politics of the project are fascinating. The ingredients are all off or about to be off patent. So the pill might be made very cheaply. So you think it'll be available widely. No way. And I'll tell you that in a minute. This is good news, but large pharmaceutical companies are not keen. Not only will the profit margin be low, but also many of the expensive drugs may be redundant. And a large generic company from India may be the one that is suited to make the polypill. And the answer is, I approached 5 big companies. Not one was interested in developing a polypill. And there are 3 companies in India that have produced it. 2 of them have stopped developing it because they don't see a profit in it, and one that we are working with is still going on. But here is the more interesting thing, and while this is said in jest, there's some truth there. But if you have the polypill, what will happen to cardiologists and cardiac surgeons? Will they have to retrain as psychiatrists? Hoping that nobody invents a happy pill to oblige further retraining. The biggest objection to the polypill has come from cardiologists, because they see themselves getting out of business. But then he goes on later to say, but do doctors need to be involved? We could do away with screening. You know, remember the discussion we just had, Peter? You know, take high-risk people on simple criteria, pop a pill, reduce heart disease by 80%, bye-bye cardiologist. But this is the biggest obstacle, vested interest. Maybe, he goes on to say, we could buy the pills in supermarkets and pubs. In the UK and here, aspirin's available over the counter. In the UK, statins are available over the counter. It's only one step further. And then he goes on to say, perhaps even washing the polypill with a glass of red wine and preventing still more deaths. Now, that's a controversial statement. So, although this is said in jest, there is truth in it. The commercial interests are not in favor of creating a polypill. The medical interests are not in favor of a polypill. Yet this is the right thing to do for humanity. And we've been at this for 10 years, but I can tell you progress is extremely slow. So here's an example. We did 2 studies, a 2,500 subject study with 8 arms, and then a second study called TIPS 1 and TIPS 2. And then we took hypertension, because the global burden of disease says hypertension is the commonest cause of death in the world, single biggest risk factor. If you use aspirin alone, statin alone, one blood pressure, you get about a 20% risk reduction in CVD. You use two or three drugs, a little more, but you put them all together at a low dose, you're getting about a 45, 50% effect. And if you put them together at a full dose, about 65%, not what Malcolm Law said about 80%, we're getting about two-thirds, but two-thirds is huge. So we then there is this clash. People say you're medicalizing people by giving the poly pill to everybody. Well, and then you should instead use lifestyle. Well, the answer is you need both. And this is a very simple modeling, saying if you did both, but you only had 50% adherence to lifestyle, that is smoking cessation, good diet, and good exercise, and 80% of the high-risk people took the poly pill, you'd get 70% risk reduction. And if 90% adherence to lifestyle, you get almost a 90% reduction. Now wait and think for a minute. What this is telling us is we have the tools to wipe out cardiovascular disease from the planet, from the face of this planet. So what is the obstacle? The obstacle is us. The obstacle is us. And that's the next phase that we've got to tackle. Now, the first obstacle is, we'd say, well, there are generic drugs. It must be affordable. So in this study, in the PURE study, we costed in each of the 650 communities the cost of these four drugs. And in the rich countries, you will see whether you were the poorest third, the richest third, or in between, the cost was low. So only 1.5% of your monthly income. This is not disposable income. Remember, disposable income is after you subtract rent and food. But you look at middle-income countries, well, the rich people can afford it, in-between people maybe, but the poor people, 10% of total income, not disposable income. Go to the low-income countries, 33% of the total income is on one condition, four drugs. And even the richest people, only 4%. Now imagine some of these people have arthritis, so they need medication for arthritis. Some of them have diabetes, so they need medication for diabetes. And of course they need to eat food. So in the poor countries, even generic drugs, which are lower cost than in Canada, are unaffordable. So the only way we can actually beat this global burden is by making these key drugs so cheap, i.e. governments provide them for free. So that is step one, and we'll come to that. So we've got four, there are four trials in the world of the poly pill going on, looking at clinical outcomes. We have the HOPE-3 study, 12,700 people. It's not quite a poly pill. We use combination blood pressure lowering or statin or their combination, and we expect the result in about 2 years. And this is primary prevention, average risk people. You know, not low risk, but average risk. TIPS-3 is a study that's the poly pill versus no poly pill in 6,000 high-risk people. It's struggling. We've got about 1,500 people. We think in 2 years we'll finish recruitment. Officially, the results are 2018. But if we get the 50% risk reduction that we expect, we might get an early closeout. Now, Iran is doing a large poly pill study. I haven't been able to find out more about it, but this is going well. And I'll talk about HOPE-4 in a minute. Now, message number three, let's step back. You all know that in the last 40 years, we've made tremendous progress in Western countries in reducing deaths from cardiovascular disease. These are the death rates from ischemic heart disease in countries where it started high, like the US, the UK, Australia, and Canada. Look at how much it's come down. That's about 2% per year. Even countries like Spain and France, where you started low, went down a little more. So it's possible to do it. How did it happen? The MONICA study, you know, this is an acronym. It's not the MONICA here doesn't start, it doesn't stand for the young lady in the White House. Here, they looked at the change in the risk score, that is primary prevention. And you'll see, as the risk score decreased, the rates of disease came down, both in men and women. But more interestingly, they also had a treatment score. They'd had four components, and this was a marker of treatment, didn't cover all the treatments. And you'll see, for every 1% decline in the improvement in the treatment score, there was a 2% decline. So treatments mattered a lot. So we as physicians can do a lot of good. And there's a person called Simon Keeple who came up with a model called the impact model, where you can model in populations the effects of risk factor change and the effects of treatment. And he's done this in 7 or 8 countries, and there are more since then. And you will see, by and large, half the benefits are better treatments, half the benefits are better risk factors, and about 5 to 20% is unexplained. I love slides that has unexplained. It means they aren't fudging the data. So what this is telling you is this can have a big effect. So now the question is, can we take what we've learned in the West and put it in the rest of the world and reduce cardiovascular disease? The answer is no. And the reason for that is we do this at an extraordinarily high cost. So we spend in Canada 11% of our GDP on health, the US 17, Europe about 8 to 10, of a much larger GDP. Whereas the poorer countries, the amount they spend on health is 3%. And they still have the double burden from infectious diseases. So how do we do it? So let's start with what we think an ideal healthcare system should be. First, it should be effective, safe, high quality with minimum waste. Second, it should be sufficient, it should be efficient, and it should be equitably distributed. This is the good thing of a nationalized healthcare system. It's equitably distributed, urban and rural. And I haven't shown you the data. The mortality rates in the rich and poor countries, urban and rural, rich countries, is the same urban and rural. Whereas you go to poor countries, rural is much higher for the same condition because they just don't have access to healthcare. The health system needs to be reliable, timely information on health determinants. We have ISIS, we have CHI, not ideal. And we need information on health system's performance. I mean, just like we have kids' school reports, we need school reports on the health systems. We need equitable access. We need adequate funding, especially to ensure that during illness, there isn't financial hardship. Just stop and think for a minute. If we didn't have the kind of healthcare system we have, when somebody is ill, they are faced with catastrophic bills. The commonest cause of personal bankruptcy in India is health. Second, like when you have somebody has an acute MI, the doctor tells the person, just go around the corner, you can buy streptokinase. They all pull their money out of their pocket or they'll pawn their jewelry. My wife's grandfather, and they're not a poor family, when he had TB 50 years ago, they sold land to buy the anti-TB drugs. Today it's different. So that's important. And remember, when somebody is ill, they're not working. So in most of these countries, when they don't have universal health care, you don't have medical coverage. And to go and see a doctor, you have to travel a day. And you have to wait in line. So in many ways, we are blessed. And ultimately, you need proper oversight and governance. And therefore, we will then lead to a system that is equitable, responsive, and protects our population from social and financial risk and leads to improved efficiency. I have worked in 4 systems. And much as we like to dump on our system, I can tell you we really have one of the best systems in the world. Now, let's take a country that's poor like Malawi. Burden. 30% of adults have hypertension, 6% have diabetes, 65% live on less than a dollar a day. The whole country has only 2 doctors and 38 nurses for every 100,000 population. More Malawian nurses are in the UK than in Malawi. Now, plan, the way they're going to do it is they integrate chronic disease management with their big burdens of TB and HIV. It's called horizontal integration. So they don't have separate system for each. They are using non-physician health workers and to control hypertension. Now, many of you may know that HIV in sub-Saharan Africa was conquered not by doctors, not by nurses. It was conquered by non-physician, non-health workers. They diagnosed HIV. They managed complex combination therapies. They manage the pneumocystis and opportunistic infections. That's how it all happened. And, but what are the barriers? Human, these people have all gone to the UK, drug stockouts, even the cheapest drugs are sometimes not available. And the reason for that is the pharmacist markup on the cheap drug, even if they do a 200% markup on a 1 cent drug, that is less of a profit for them than a 50% markup on a $10 drug. This may sound incredible to you, but there was a recent article in the New England Journal about cancer chemotherapy in the US. You're all aware that in the US, most of the oncologists make their money by treating patients in their offices, and they can put a markup. So when a cheap generic is available versus an expensive drug, they give the expensive drug because their markup is worth more. So it's a human phenomenon. Stockouts, we talked about access, distance, legal. Because in most countries, we have put barriers that doctors can be the only ones that prescribe. You know, as somebody equipped, the biggest impediment to improving healthcare are physicians. I think that's going too far, but at least some physicians, I would say. And obviously, patient attitudes about long-term care, two things. They need to be seen by a doctor. If they're not seen by a doctor, they think they haven't got the best therapy. And the second is the moment they feel better, they stop taking their medication, especially if their medications cost 35% of their disposable income. So these are all the barriers they have to face. But there is a country that is beating it, and that is Brazil. In Brazil in 2007, 72% of all deaths were due to NCDs, half of which was cardiovascular disease and diabetes. There was a 50% decline between 89 and 2009 in smoking. In 2011, they had 32,000 family healthcare teams. These teams had one physician, one nurse, one auxiliary nurse, a bunch of community health worker, and there was one per 1,000 family or one per 5,000 people. At present, it covers 100 million people, about 60% of the population of Brazil. They cover these groups. And Brazil said is, we can't deal with everything. We're going to take the 10 most important conditions, and that's what we're going to focus on. That led to a marked increase in primary healthcare use, a 24% decline in NCD, and a 25% reduction in mortality. So even in middle-income countries and low-income countries, this can work. The Rockefeller has a publication called Good Health at Low Costs. This includes Vietnam, Sri Lanka, the state of Kerala that I am from, Costa Rica, and one other country. And these are models where you can actually deliver good health at low cost. And we in Canada have a lot to learn from them. Now, let us philosophically step back and go to the causation of an NCD, and in this case, atherosclerosis and cardiovascular disease. We can start off at birth, and these are various points of death. And, you know, it is a societal disease where we're exposed to a sea of risk factors from day one. You know, so if parents eat an unhealthy diet, the child at the age of one will be eating hamburgers and the wrong things. If the parents are sitting in front of a TV, the kids sit in front of a TV. So that occurs, and then you come to a certain threshold that you may call the prevention threshold. And then it goes on to the subclinical disease threshold and then to the clinical disease threshold. And at each stage, you can intervene. So if you intervene here, you can push out the eventual event. If you intervene there, you can push out the eventual event. But ultimately, if you change society as a whole, you're going to change that trajectory that way, and that would be called intergenerational prevention. So get the parents to do things right, the children will do right. So the last discussion was statins in the drinking water. I don't think we are at the stage of statins in the breast milk. So we're doing a study in first a pilot in two countries and then ultimately 10 countries, which is called HOPE4, which is taking what we know, packaging it into a simple, cost-effective intervention and see whether we can reduce cardiovascular disease by 35% over and above current care. And what we do here is This is the full scale, 190 communities. We've only been funded for 50 communities in a pilot. The grant is pending. These are all low and middle income countries. And we've just added Canada. We're going to be working in the inner cities in Canada and the Aboriginal population. The screening is systematic house-to-house screening in communities. Communities are randomized for simple prevalent cardiovascular disease. And these are not nurses. These are high school graduates with some training. And they say, do you know if you've got heart attack, stroke, whatever? Second is, do you know if you've got diabetes? And for hypertension, we give them an automated cuff. So they measure that. And based on that, they get a risk score on a little tablet, handheld tablet. It's zoomed to a central place centrally, and the physician immediately says, treat, non-treat. But in reality, studies have shown that these non-physician health workers make the same decision as the physicians over 95% of the time. But we're doing that because of the legal barriers. And so they then dole out a low-dose poly pill, and there are 2-3 versions depending on side effects. And the other group, the control communities, are told, you're at risk, go to your local clinic. And then the idea is to see a few years later what happens. The last couple of themes I want to talk about is health and wealth. The world as a whole has gradually become wealthier. Between the year 1000 and the year 1900, there was practically no change in life expectancy in most of the world. From 1800s to 1900s, there was an improvement in the West. But since 1900s, both the developed and the developing countries have shown a marked improvement in health, and it tracks wealth. So there are many diseases of poverty that we have that can be need to be conquered, and we call this neglected cardiovascular diseases. Rheumatic heart disease, Chagas disease, TB pericarditis, peripartum cardiomyopathies, and nutritional cardiomyopathies. And as we improve wealth, these diseases disappear, and they disappear without us ever finding out what actually caused them or how to control them. There are many diseases in history that have disappeared without us really researching them, just by improving the poverty thing. Of course, we know something about rheumatic heart disease. We have a large registry going on of just 3,000 people. We're getting to 10,000. We've got a big study on Chagas in South America, a big study of 3,000 people should report next year. Carlos Murillo is leading it. TB pericarditis, we have a 50% mortality at 6 months. We have a large study that's finished recruitment of 1,400 people, testing a couple of interventions. But while they will make an impact, the real impact is lifting people out of poverty. So I'll summarize in the next few slides. There are 7 strategies, I would say, to reduce cardiovascular disease by 50% in the next 25 years. We need to study diverse and large numbers of people. Diverse because if you get the spread of the exposure of diseases, like I showed you from Pure. By studying people, you immediately shine a light on their problems. That means somebody will do something about them, or they themselves will do something about it. And you've got to study them long term. Now, incidentally, this is a byline, cardiovascular disease of chronic diseases is the easiest disease to beat. Why? Because the causes of heart disease and stroke and heart failure are more or less the same. It's common. 35% of the people at some stage get it. So you don't need huge studies. But take cancer. Cancer is probably 20 or 30 different conditions. The incidence is much lower. So to study cardiovascular disease, I need 200,000 people. To study cancer, I need studies that are 25 times larger. 25 times larger, and they don't exist right now. People aren't thinking that way. We need a few thousand breast cancers of each subtype in order to understand breast cancer. So we're setting up a big study called the Millions of Person Studies, and the reason is millions, is we don't know how many millions we'll get. We've already done a pilot in Kerala, and we're trying to do one in sentinel regions of the world, Southeast Asia, China, Turkey, South America, and Africa. It's a long journey. It'll take us at least 10 years to know whether we'll even succeed putting it together. But if we do, then just like in cardiovascular disease, we can start to shine light on cancers. We need to improve the wealth of societies. We need to integrate various disciplines that have worked in silos. Epidemiology, yes. Health policy, very important. I'm going next week to a place in Oxford called the Blavatnik School of Government because I believe governments have a major role to play in improving health. Yet, we think of politicians much the way we think of our friend in Toronto, but politicians and health have, and governments have a major role. We need to study environmental sciences. I'm a deep believer that a large part of the causes of cancers is in our water, in our soil. It could be arsenic, organophosphates, it could be endosulfans, it could be any one of these. And so in our study, we're collecting water from every household and storing it. And later on, we will try to link that, looking at clusters, because we recruited people by clusters, 658 communities now, later 750, and we can look at clusters of these. We are studying air pollution. We are collaborating with people in UBC, and we're using NASA satellites to triangulate and give us air pollution, PM2.5, PM2, 10, and sulfur dioxide levels at a few kilometers above the Earth, because you can't get it right down to ground levels. And the resolution of these are 10 by 10 kilometers. So we need to go into that. We need to understand multi-system physiology. And a good example of that is Margaret Vente wrote a really interesting article 2 weeks back on Saturday. But the line that was memorable to me is, she said, most nutrition science is junk science. And I have to agree with it. Whereas nutrition is one of the most important things. And I believe the gut biome is a very important area because we eat, most of our sciences, we sort of assess what people eat, then we see what disease they get. But a whole lot of thing happens in between. Your gut biome makes a big change to what happens to what you eat. And so that's something we need to get into. And so these diverse sciences will provide new insights. We need legislative strategies. Yes, we can dump on our politicians, but we have to work with them. It's only they who can help us control the industrial epidemics of tobacco, processed food, soft drinks, and obesogenic environments. This one, we're not very good at. Effective and innovative communications. Maybe we should just get these young kids who sit in dark rooms and play and write programs to come up with new tools. Maybe the new tools of the handheld devices and computer games have a health message in it. We have to start with new tools. Peter, you could be a hero there. Access to low-cost smart generics. We've talked about the poly pill, but believe me, antiretroviral therapies, combination pills. For TB, it's combination pills. For cancer, it's combination, if not all in one. So combination pills is the future. Medical school, I was taught combination was the wrong way to go. You had to give each drug, titrate each drug. We know that's humbug by and large. So we have to change our medical paradigm. And we need to spend much more time understanding health systems. How many of us have been taught about what a health system is? How a health system should be, rational health system should be designed? Rational health investments? None of us have. So medical education has to be transformed from the biology-based, Marx-oriented system to a more societal-based system that brings in business, communication, legislation, policy, and integration of health systems. That's what's going to be needed to beat the diseases of the 21st centuries. So how do we make all this happen? We need to start to think far bigger than what we have ever done before. We need to work with disciplines that we normally don't work with. We're working with engineers to develop paper strips that can be used for bedside diagnosis to say when somebody has an acute respiratory infection, is it eosinophils or neutrophils? And we're just about to mount a trial where we randomize people based on whether it's eosinophils or neutrophils. If it's eosinophils, more steroids. If it's neutrophils, antibiotics. And this lab on a chip can be done in rural Rwanda. So this is the kind of new things we have to get into. We need to take advantage of the enormous geographic and temporal heterogeneity that exists in the world. We learn much more by working across the world than the narrow perspective of most countries. Well, CIHR is Canadian, so we only fund Canadian studies. In fact, it's exactly the opposite. We learn more by collaborating and funding studies worldwide. And here are two good examples where other fields have gone before us and done much better. The massive Large Hadron Collider under the French and Swiss Alps. It is a multinational collaboration, and that's how the Higgs boson of the God particle was discovered. Or the Hubble telescope that is telling us so much more about the galaxies than any single telescope that's sitting on Earth. So let us dream big, let's dream wide, and let's go where no man has gone before. Thank you.
Questions, yeah. Dr. Hashinsky?
That was brilliant and inspiring. I think one of the factors that you have not addressed is that all of the things you're advocating involve human behavior. And as we know, that's extremely difficult to change. So do you have some additional insights on how we can succeed?
Well, if you try and to address human behavior one individual at a time, like smoking cessation, eat the right diet, be active, we're more often likely to fail than succeed. We all know that, everybody here does. So the only way you can change that is, as Jeffrey Rhodes said, is you have to swim with the tide. We've got to make the tide go the right way. Smoking will now decline rapidly. I predict in 25 years, we're seeing the end game of smoking. Because society as a whole has made tobacco unacceptable. So that'll happen. So for instance, if we change the nature of this auditorium, and instead of all of you sitting there comfortably and me standing here, maybe you're all sitting on little balls, and every minute you're expending one calorie. Or as I talk, you're walking around me. So the nature of buildings will have to change for us to be active. The nature of cities have to change. So doing the right thing has to be de facto rather than a change of behavior. So the right behavior should be confluent with the environment. I don't think we can get people to eat the right things or do the right exercise with the wrong environment. Now, changing the environment is going to take time, and it's going to take legislation. That's the simplest thing I can say. There's another part of behavior, which is called self-interest. You know, this is why, you know, the OMA will never agree to rational change if it involves even 1 cent decrease in a physician's salary. So we have to start to think of how we can change that. So is there a mechanism by which self-interest can be turned into the interests of the common? I don't know the answer to that last one, incidentally, and I'm not going to risk it because I'm sure there's an OMA representative and I'll be thrown out tomorrow. But the point I'm trying to say is we have to change the environment to get the right behavioral answer. And I don't have the solutions, Vlad. Maybe our grandchildren will have the solutions. But does it make sense? Jeffrey Rose was the one who said you have to change the tide to get everybody to do the right thing. So, and hopefully at a instinctive level, it makes sense. You know, the devil is in the detail and how you actually do it.
Other questions? Dr. Calvin?
I'm intrigued about the models.
Can you take the,
And the non-physician community health worker. I'm actually doing research with community health workers for managing heart failure on inner city patients in Chicago. One of the difficulties we really have is the secondary prevention of a disease like heart failure, where what we're finding is the patients aren't taking the pills. So delivery is an issue. Being able to get a complicated regime well understood by the patient, but they'll still find other reasons not to take it. I was wondering if you could expand a little bit on what you've been doing with primary prevention as to what where this could go with diseases like heart failure, which are more complicated regimens for patients, and how that we might use polypills and community health workers there.
I think the polypill is only one part of the solution, and it may be even historically a temporary part of the solution. Just like in Western countries, PCI is replacing thrombolysis. Everything is only a halfway technology. But our work we've been going into, we're identifying a handful of conditions and looking at the barriers to treatment. So the barriers to the treatment could be systemic. It could be individual. It could be cost. It could be attitudinal. It could be cultural. Let me start with cultural. In many societies, if you're healthy, taking a pill is a bad idea, because if you take a pill, you're seen as sick. So the moment a doctor tells you your blood pressure is under control, they say, good, I don't need to take pills. And in fact, sometimes doctors believe that too. The second issue is our healthcare model. Patients have to go to the doctors. But in the Health Hope 4 study, the healthcare team is on the doorstep of the home. I forgot to mention that, because they're going house to house. And the medication's given free, and the checkup is free. Of course, in India, DOTS therapy for TB is that way. Vaccines for children is that way. So there are models of... So maybe in future, instead of heart failure patients coming to the heart function clinic or even going to their GP, you have some people who are trained, who actually calls them regularly, and when it seems their symptoms are worse or the weight has gone up, they go and visit them. So the model is for common conditions that where the management is non-toxic and where you don't need investigation. Instead of the patient coming to the doctor or to the healthcare system goes to the patient. So that way, if somebody is healthier, they don't have to take a day off work. They don't have to pay for their parking, at least in Canada, as they do. So there's a number of different strategic changes we have to make in the healthcare system. Because the healthier you are, the more you have to go out to them. And obviously, if people are very sick, they have difficulty. So that's the other part. Surprisingly, when we are doing the study of the access to drugs, we're finding that in about 20% of the 750 communities, these four basic drugs are not available in the pharmacies. Surprising. And the issue on cost just bowled me over. This is a PhD student, Russia is working on that. It just bowled me over. You know, to say that simple four cheap drugs, 33% of somebody's income, and when you say in a poor country like India, in rural India, 80% of the income is on food, well, then the cost of these drugs is more than what's left. No wonder they're not taking it, especially when they feel healthy. So I think the strategy to improving adherence, to improving all this, will depend on the social, economic, and health systems context. So that's why I started off with sociological factors are contextual, biological factors are deterministic. We in medicine have tended to focus on the deterministic side, and we need to start to move into the social side. When I was training in the UK and we did rounds, the social worker was with us on every round. And in the UK MRCP exam, you had to describe social history, you know, as part. And if you didn't, you'd fail. I don't know whether that's required by the Royal College. I certainly say that when I do rounds in CCU, the social worker is hardly there. I need to get a consult to get the person in. So I think it's the change. We've gone into a technology-oriented biological mode, which has served us well, but not enough. So I'm sorry, it's a very sort of non-specific answer, but that's the best I can do. Thank you.
Other questions? Yes. Just wait for the microphone.
Hi, wonderful talk. I had a question about your top four markers or contributors to cardiovascular disease, and you omitted genetics because of the time frame. I'm just wondering about the impact, the potential impact of exogenous chemicals potentially modifying epigenetics, so the modification of genes that we all have, and just about potential expression changes because of those.
Yes, and Guy, don't get a heart attack. I think genetics have practically no role for cardiovascular disease, and I'll say this based on data. I didn't want to contradict my friend whom I work with. We've done a study in the Interheart study where we've looked at what all the known SNPs contribute, 1%. Okay, and this has come again and again and again. It's sexy, it's exciting, it will learn some biology, and there'll be an occasional gene like the PCSK9 gene that will lead to something, but those are therapies, it's not in prediction. It is also true that in the prediction of cancer, genes will play a small role. In the treatment of some cancers, you can personalize it. So you've got to take that distinction apart. Epigenetics is the latest buzzword, like God. I don't know something, so God exists. Sorry, I hope I don't offend anybody. I've done enough of that already. But epigenetics is the next refuge of the scoundrel, let me put it that way. For 25, 30, how many Nobel Prizes has genetics got? 15, 20? How many diseases has it helped cure? How many people has it saved? Practically nothing compared to smoking that hasn't got a single Nobel Prize and a single thing. So coming back to genetics, I have a cartoon from George Davy Smith, the well-known British epidemiologist, some of you may know. I actually took it out here in deference to my colleague, Guy, which says, when you don't know something, say it's epigenetics. Honestly, if you're getting into that area, don't bother, you're wasting your life.
Yes.
Now, Rob knows, I've held this view for 20 years.
Now, all I can say to that is...
And we've collaborated.
Very nice, Salim, very nice.
Touche. But also think of it like this, from a stochastic point of view. You know, you said there are 1,700-odd SNPs for various conditions. Now you're going to have multiple environmental. How on earth are you going to make sense of it? It's okay.
Other questions?
That was a showstopper.
Yeah. No, I think it is getting late, and in fact, we have now another celebrity from Hollywood who's waiting for us. So,
can I make one comment?
Yeah, of course.
You know, so that you don't misunderstand my point of view, I actually co-author a number of genetics papers with Rob and with Guy and others, and I think genetics will help us understand some biology, okay? And in fact, your work helps us that. You've always told me all it takes is one zebra to tell you not everything is a horse, or something like that. You've done some very nice work. So I think some biological phenomenon we will understand through genetics. Some diseases for which we don't have causes, it may be genetics. And obviously some things that are obviously inheritable will find it. But for a common condition that, like cardiovascular disease, that affects 35% of the population, how can it be genetics? When something is so common, it can't be genetics. So, you know, step back and think of it. And when something didn't exist in 1900 and then is extremely common in 1950, how can it be genetics? So take the big view of it. So I'm not saying genetics doesn't have a role. Genetics has a role in certain areas, but not in common conditions.
Other comments or questions? Anyway, again, thank you, Salim. It's been a tremendous day. Congratulations on this well-deserved recognition. It's been our honor to sponsor you and look forward to you receiving the award at the banquet tonight. So thank you again.
Thank you.